Well, let me welcome you tonight to this, my gospel broadcast from Sandown Free Presbyterian Church. We're glad that you're able to join with us tonight. And we appreciate you taking the time to join with us on this special broadcast tonight. From wherever you're watching and however you're watching, we're glad to see you and thank you for being a part of this gospel service tonight as we come around the Word of God. As we listen to the Word of God, we read the Word of God, we hear the hymn has been sung. It is our desire, it is our prayer that the Lord would speak to us all tonight, wherever we are, that the Lord would be pleased to speak to hearts. And most of all tonight, the purpose of our gospel meeting every Sunday night is that if you're not saved, the purpose is that you would this night, while you may not be in the physical building, yet the Lord can speak to you. The Lord can challenge your heart, and praise God, he can save you. And it's our prayer that tonight, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, that even as we go through this gospel service tonight, that the Lord would speak to your heart and the Lord would save your soul. I want you to take your Bible, please. And I trust you have your Bible with you. And I want you to turn with me to the Gospel of Mark. I want you to turn to Mark's Gospel in the chapter 1. And we're going to read the first 11 verses of this chapter together as we commence this gospel service tonight. Mark's Gospel, chapter 1. And we read there in the opening verse, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophets, "Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make his path straight. John did baptize in the wilderness and preached the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And there went out unto him all the land of Judea, and they of Jerusalem, and were all baptized of him in the river of Jordan, confessing their sins. And John was clothed with camel's hair and with a girdle of a skin about his loins. And he did eat locusts and wild honey, and preached, saying, There cometh one mightier than I after me, the latchet of whose shoes I am not worthy to stoop down and unloose. I indeed have baptized you with water, but he shall baptize you with the Holy Ghost. And it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee, and was baptized of John in Jordan. And straightway coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens opened, and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, Thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. May the Lord be pleased to bless the reading of his word to all of our hearts. Let's unite together, please, in prayer. I ask you, please, to pray with us, pray for us, and to pray that the Lord would bless this broadcast tonight and speak to all of our hearts. Let's all pray. Eternal God and our Father, we come into thy holy presence again this evening. And Lord, we thank thee tonight that while we may be separated one from the other, and while we may not be able to gather, Lord, in a public fashion such as the manner is, O God, we thank thee that no matter where we are, the Lord can be with us and the Lord is with us. And Heavenly Father, we draw into thy presence tonight in that sure and certain hope that we will be heard, not because of who we are or what we are, but all because of who Christ is and all that he has done for us. We thank thee, O God, tonight for the atoning, finished work of Christ there on the cross. We thank thee, Lord, tonight that we can say in the words of the hymn writer that we need no other argument and we need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died and that he died for me. O Heavenly Father, we thank thee this evening that you paid that once for all sacrifice for sin. We thank the Lord tonight that there is no more sacrifice for sin. We praise the Lord tonight for the gospel message that Jesus saves whosoever will that cometh unto him through the Lord Jesus Christ. O God, we pray that tonight you be pleased, even in this gospel service, to speak to hearts. Lord, as the word of God is read, Lord, as the hymns are sung to us tonight, Heavenly Father, we pray that you be pleased to speak. And most especially tonight, Lord, in the gospel, Lord, as we consider thy word tonight, O Lord, speak to hearts, we pray. Heavenly Father, we ask that as people would gather around their laptops, their computers, their phones, or whatever, and listen to this broadcast, O God, we pray, most of all, that the Holy Spirit will take a dealing with every heart and life. Lord, that you'll reach into hearts and reach into homes. Lord, that we know nothing about. Oh, Heavenly Father, we pray that you be pleased, even for your glory and for your honor. Save souls tonight, O God, we pray. Our Father, we thank thee for this means whereby we can still communicate and preach and proclaim the gospel. And Heavenly Father, we pray that you bless the word. Lord, not only as it goes forth, Lord, from Sandown tonight, but across our land, and ye, Lord, across our world tonight. We thank thee, Lord, tonight that the internet has been flooded with the message of God's word. Use thy word, O God, we pray, that even in the midst of all the crisis that is unfolding around us, O Heavenly Father, we pray that hearts will be turned to the Lord Jesus Christ. O God, we thank thee for the opportunity that has been afforded to us this afternoon to meet together and to pray and to intercede on behalf of our nation. And Heavenly Father, we cry unto thee tonight for your mercy's sake alone. Be pleased to answer prayer. O Lord, stem this virus, O God, we pray. And Lord, while the prediction is for weeks and months, O God, we thank thee tonight that thou art well able to do things above, beyond what we could ask or think. O Heavenly Father, we pray to be pleased to step in. And Lord, be pleased to preserve life, O God, we ask. But O God, we pray that in the midst of it all may you speak. Heavenly Father, we pray that the voice of God might be heard. And especially, God, as we come to the gospel tonight, may thy voice be heard. O Heavenly Father, speak. Lord, speak very clearly this evening. Lord, take the words of this preacher. Feel, and Lord, vain though they may be in the flesh in which they come, O God, use them to thine honour. And to thy glory, O God, we pray. Heavenly Father, we pray you please to just gather with us tonight. Lord, wherever we may be, Heavenly Father, we pray that we might know that God is with us. And the Holy Spirit is speaking to all of our hearts. So please be pleased to bless us tonight. Continue with us, Lord, we pray. And glorify thy great name. Remember all those who are in need again tonight. Heavenly Father, we pray tonight for those who are afflicted. Lord, for those who are in hospital tonight or struggling, O God, we pray that you'll minister to them, touch them. O God, we pray that they might realize, Lord, that this life, it is so short, and that there needs to be that readiness, there needs to be that preparation. O Heavenly Father, we pray that you'll speak to hearts, touch lives. O God, we pray. Remember all those who have the duty of care. Bless every medical person, we pray. O Heavenly Father, keep your hand upon them. Give them great wisdom and put your hand of protection upon them as well. Remember our homes. Remember our congregation for good. O God, we pray. And Lord, the wider congregation, Lord, as they would join with us tonight by means of sermon audio or Facebook Live, come, O God, we pray. Heavenly Father, come and bless us. Do our hearts good. In the Saviour's name we pray. Amen. Amen. I wonder if you've ever been sitting in church and your mind has begun to wander. Now, I don't want you to answer that, just in case I get offended and all that and get very upset. But I'm sure there are times that you've sat in church when you've been able to join with us and your mind is beginning to wander. And you start thinking about maybe things that happened to you in the week that has passed. And then you start to think about what you need to do in the week that lies ahead. And you're not really listening to the preacher. And you're thinking about other things and you're not really listening or really going with what's going on in the meeting. Well, tonight I want to tell you about someone who was like that. Her name was Elvina. And Elvina was sitting in church, as she always did, one Sunday morning. It was a very hot, warm Sunday morning. And her mind started to wander. She was a member of the choir. And as she sat there with the other members of the choir, she wasn't really taking in what was taking place in the meeting. And her mind started to wander. But her mind started to wander to think about her Saviour. And especially she was brought to the cross. And she started to think about that place called Golgotha. She started to think about her Saviour. And she started to think about the price that her Saviour paid in order to redeem her soul from sin.
And in her mind's eye, she could see those three crosses there on Golgotha's hill. On either side, on the two outer sides, she could see the two thieves being punished for the crimes that they had done. And then all of a sudden, it was as if her mind went into darkness. And all she could see was blackness. Oh yes, she could see the two thieves. And there in the middle, she could see another cross. She could see her Savior. And then the darkness came. And the blackness that engulfed the earth at that time came over her mind. And she started to realize that it was during those hours of darkness that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, paid the debt for her sin. And as the darkness engulfed her mind, she could hear a voice cry out. And that voice cried out just one word. And that word in the Greek was tetelestai, which means finished. And that's all she could hear. Finished. Finished. She thought of those wonderful words recorded for us in John's Gospel, chapter 19 and the verse 30, when Christ cried from the cross, "It is finished." Or just in the original, "finished." See, that one word, tetelestai, in the original meaning, it has another thought. It is an accounting term. Because when a bill was settled and a debt was settled, it was often that word that was written over that debt. It meant it was paid in full. And Elvin Hall that day was so gripped with that truth that the debt of her sins was paid in full by Christ on the cross. That he, in his own body on the tree, paid it all. And as the pastor continued to speak, Elvina Hall took up her hymn book and she flicked to a blank page inside the cover and she started to write down the words of a poem. At the end of the service, she gave the words to her pastor. She didn't tell the pastor how she came to write the poem. But she gave the words to her pastor on the way out, and the pastor was very intrigued by it. Because that very same week, the church organist had composed a new hymn tune with no words in mind. All he had was a tune, but he had no words. And he had passed it on to the pastor as well, saying you could maybe put words to that. And the pastor went home, went into his study, and he took down the sheet of music and he took down the words that Elvina Hall had written down on that page. And it all started to flow together. And the words exactly matched the tune. And through it all, at the end of it all, there were the words of a hymn that we sing so often, entitled, "Jesus Paid It All." You see, through that song, Elvina Hall realized her own inability to save herself. She said, "For nothing good have I, whereby thy grace to claim, I'll wash my garments white in the blood of Calvary's Lamb." She said, "And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save, my lips shall still repeat." And the chorus emphasized that truth over and over again. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. Paid in full. Thank God tonight, if you come to Jesus Christ, rest upon him and repent of your sin, he will wash away every stain of sin, because he has paid it all. He has paid it in full. Isn't that the gospel of grace tonight? That Christ in love did for us what we cannot do, because he paid it all. Thank God tonight the work of redemption is accomplished. Praise God tonight, he, the cross of Calvary, paid it all. Listen to the words now of that lovely hymn, written all those years ago by Elvina Hall one Sunday morning in church. Jesus paid it all.
May that truth grip our hearts even tonight, that Jesus did pay it all. We want to welcome you again tonight to this live gospel broadcast here from Sandown Road Free Presbyterian Church. While you're not able to join with us tonight, yet we in person here in the church, yet we're glad that you're able to join with us by way either of sermon audio or Facebook Live. Thank you so much for tuning in. We trust the Lord will keep his hand upon you, and the Lord will bless you richly. And even the week that lies ahead, the Lord will protect you, and the Lord will be very near to you. These are very difficult times, very trying times for everyone. And we pray for you. We want you to be assured of our prayerful support for you. Can I say that as your pastor, if you need me in any way, I'm still available for you. Please do get in touch with us at any time. Lift the phone and get in touch with us. But we want you to know that you're not forgotten. And while we may be separated, yet it's so thrilling and encouraging to hear how that as a congregation we are still keeping in contact. And may the Lord bless you. And for those outside of the congregation, we are thankful for you being with us, joining with us tonight and on the other occasions as well. You're very, very welcome. And we trust the Lord will bless us all. Do continue to be much in prayer. I know much prayer has been offered this afternoon across our churches, across our families of our churches. And let's pray that the Lord will continue to intervene in this awful crisis that we find ourselves in at this time. Can I just remind you of the broadcasts as they continue throughout the rest of this week? Now, it's very strange because you normally say the services, the meetings as they continue, because normally we're gathering here in the church building. But of course, because of the restrictions, that is not possible. But the Word of God is still going forth. And in fact, the Word of God is reaching further than ever before. For that we are so thankful. And so on Tuesday night at 7 o'clock, we have the Explorers Bible Club continue. It is thrilling to see that on Tuesday night past, over 2,000 people have viewed the Explorers Bible Club, and that's thrilling. That really is encouraging. So we want you to join in on Tuesday night as well, no matter what age you are. Whether you're 2, 20, or maybe a slightly more than that. It doesn't matter. We're glad to have you. You join in, and we want you to spread the word. We'll be putting up the details again on Facebook, and we want you to spread it far and wide. Get all your friends informed and try to get them to watch in on Tuesday night at 7 o'clock for the Explorers Bible Club with the boys and girls. And then on Thursday night at 8 o'clock, the discipleship course will continue, and we'll continue to learn more about our God on Thursday night. So again, we encourage you to join in, and if you want to get a copy of the notes, please do get in contact with us, message us or email us, garth@sandownfpc.org, almost forgot there, but garth@sandownfpc.org, and we'll get the notes out to you. So remember, broadcast on Thursday night, the discipleship course, and we learn more about God. And then on Friday night, there'll be another short video message to the young people, and James will be bringing a short video message to the young people this Friday night, God willing. So again, tune in 8 o'clock to listen to that video message. So all of those meetings on Tuesday at 7, Thursday at 8, and Friday at 8 will all be going out on Facebook live. So spread the word and get as many involved in it as possible. Then, God willing, we'll be back here in the church next Sunday at 11:30 and 6:30 on sermon audio as well as Facebook Live. And we trust that you're able to join with us. We always like to have singers on our Sunday evening gospel services. We have a special singer again tonight, and God willing, over the next number of Sunday nights, we're going to have a special singer as well. We had this fellow singing for us just a few weeks ago, and he's very kindly agreed to sing for us again tonight, but he's not here in person. He very kindly recorded some songs for us and sent them through. And that's our brother Philip Bowles. We always enjoy Philip's ministry in song. And we're going to listen to Philip sing now a well-known gospel piece, "He Touched Me."
Thank you.
Thanks to Philip for taking the time to record that song, and he has other recordings done for us, and others as well have very kindly done that, and we'll be listening to them, God willing, over the next number of weeks. I want you to turn back in the Word of God this evening to the Old Testament this time, and to the book of Proverbs. Book of Proverbs and the chapter 29. Book of Proverbs, chapter 29. Trust you bear with us in all the technical parts of this. It's a learning curve for us, but we have a wonderful media team who are helping and are working behind the scenes and are doing a great job. And so we thank them for all that they are doing and continue to do. But we're learning on the hoof here, as it was. But I hope you're enjoying the meetings and enjoying these broadcasts. Proverbs chapter 29. I want to speak this evening on the gospel of the subject of the greatest health warning. The greatest health warning. And I just want to read one verse, Proverbs chapter 29 and the verse number 1. It says, "He that been often reproved hardeneth his neck, shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy." He that been often reproved hardeneth his neck, shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. Can we just please come to the Lord in prayer? And I ask you please very especially to pray. The meeting tonight, the message tonight, will be very solemn. A very solemn, sobering message. And I pray that as it goes tonight across the internet and to many homes, and I don't know where this message will go to. I don't know all who are listening tonight. It's my prayer. It's the prayer of many tonight. And if you're listening, you're watching without Christ, you don't know Christ as your Saviour, that you would listen tonight and you would heed this message. Let's bow in prayer. Eternal God and our Father, we thank thee for all that has taken place already. We thank thee for the messages and song. And Heavenly Father, we pray tonight that as we come around the Word of God, O God, speak tonight, we pray. May we hear the voice of God. And far beyond the voice of a preacher, Lord, may the Spirit of God speak. And may the Spirit of God strive. O God, bless us tonight, we pray. Give us help, Lord, in the preaching of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and speak to souls. O Heavenly Father, we pray that solemnity might fall tonight. And Lord, that those who are listening out of Christ, may they realize the awful danger they're in. So hear and answer prayer and continue with us. Give help in the preaching tonight. Give help, Lord, to each one who'll hear. And most of all, Lord, we pray, save the lost. In the Saviour's name we pray. Amen. So what started off with instructions to make sure that we wash our hands more regularly and more effectively quickly progressed to the announcement made on Monday evening past by the Prime Minister, with almost a blanket ban on any type of movement within our nation. We are told to socially distance ourselves from others, and when we do have to go out, to ensure that we keep at least 2 metres distance from everyone at all times. This new term of social distancing is to prevent the spread of the virus amongst others. It's to protect ourselves, it's to protect our families, and it is to protect the NHS. But hour by hour now, we are being issued with ever more health warnings. This constant message of guarding against the virus and stopping the spread and the transmission of the virus, these warnings must be heeded. These instructions must be obeyed for the preservation of life, for the protection of ourselves and others. You see, tonight our society has changed dramatically, almost overnight. Our way of life, our social interaction, even the ministry of the local church, it has all changed beyond recognition in the space of such a short space of time, as our nation heeds the warnings that are being issued. Yet tonight, I want us to think about another warning. And tonight a greater warning. Because greater than the voice that comes from the leader of our nation, greater than the advice from the chief medical officer, there is another warning tonight. There is another voice, and it is the voice of Almighty God. Because you see, in this global emergency and crisis that we are in tonight, God is speaking. Of course, God is always speaking. But this is a time, I believe, more than any other, and he's speaking louder than ever before. In fact, he's had to silence out all the noise. And God is speaking tonight. And he's had to quieten and silence people in order that his voice might be heard. He is issuing warnings to this world. He is reminding this world that he is the one who is in control. He is the one who sets up and the one who puts down. He is in the one who is in control tonight. And he, tonight, is saying that he is God and God alone. That he is God in heaven who doeth according to the counsel of his will, and none can stay his hand, and none dare say, what doest thou? God is warning this world of his judgment. God is speaking globally tonight. But for the rest of this meeting, and as we bring this broadcast to a close, I want you to know that God is speaking personally. And he's speaking personally to you tonight. This evening, whoever you are or wherever you're listening or watching this broadcast from, God is speaking to you tonight. And tonight in the gospel, I want us to hear from God as we look at this greatest health warning, not about our physical health, but our spiritual health. In Proverbs 29 in the verse 1, we read those words, he that being often reproved hardeneth his neck shall suddenly be destroyed. Not without warning. Here we have one of the most solemn verses of Scripture. Here we have one of the most sobering warnings in all of Scripture. And tonight, as God is speaking globally, yet I want you to see tonight that God is speaking to you personally. In your home tonight. Wherever you are tonight, God is speaking to you, and don't miss it. He's issuing a warning to you tonight. If you fail to heed the health warnings that have been issued, it could be fatal. It could take your life. And sadly, many have already succumbed to this virus. But I want you to see and I want you to know tonight that there is a fate worse than death. There's a fate worse than losing your life. Because you can lose your soul in a lost eternity. You can lose your soul tonight, your never dying soul. If you were to die without Christ and taken into eternity without Christ, you would be banished in hell for all eternity without Christ. And that's why then this issue, this warning is issued. I want you to see, first of all, with me here, the detail of this warning. We have the detail there in verse Number one, the opening line, he that been often reproved. There's the detail of this warning. He that been often reproved. What does that mean? Really, the warning could be summed up in that one word, reprove. It means to rebuke. It means to correct. It carries the idea of telling someone of the error of their ways. It pointing out to them that they're on the wrong way. They're doing the wrong thing. Of course, the many health warnings that have been issued lately have been issued to warn people to take care and be cautious. They need to prevent the transmission of the coronavirus. They need to prevent themselves from contracting COVID-19. But here's a greater warning. A word of rebuke, a word of correction. The Holy Spirit tonight is warning you, instructing you, rebuking you. What is this all about? What is the reproof? Will you turn with me, please, and I trust you still have your Bible open there. Turn with me, please, to the Gospel of John in the chapter 16. John's Gospel, chapter 16, and the verse number 8. And here we have this reproof. This correction that we have read of in Proverbs 29 and verse 1, what is it? In verse number 8, John chapter 16 in the verse 8, it says, when he is come, that is the Holy Spirit, he will reprove. Reprove of what? Of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. That's what this warning entails. It's reproving the sinner tonight of sin. It's telling you tonight that you are a sinner, that you're born in sin. You're lost without Christ. It reproves of righteousness. It corrects you from the notion that you think you can do all right without Christ. That your own righteousnesses are all right as you think. Your own good living is enough. He corrects you, he reproves you of that notion, and he shows to you tonight that no matter who you are or what you are, you can't save yourself. He reproves as well of judgment. He warns tonight that you will be judged for your sin. You cannot escape that. One day you'll have to answer before God. And if you meet God on that day of judgment still in your sin, that day when all the books are opened and that book, the book of life is opened and your name is not recorded there, then you will be judged and you will be damned in a lost eternity for all eternity. The Holy Spirit tonight is reproving you, telling you you're lost, you're a sinner, you can't save yourself. And that you will one day be judged for your sin. You've been warned tonight. The Holy Spirit is issuing this warning to you tonight. And I say in love to your soul, heed that warning. And flee from the judgment to come. That's the meaning of the detail of this warning. But I want you to see as well, as we think of the detail, the mercy of this warning. You see, the fact that you are, you have been warned tonight, it's all due to the mercy of God. The very fact that you are alive tonight, that you have breath in your body, is due to the mercy of God. The very fact that we have salvation, that there is a gospel message tonight, is all down to the mercy of God. God's mercy is seen in redemption, but God's mercy is also seen in creation. In all of his works, you see the hand of a merciful God. Thomas Watson, the old Puritan, said that every time you draw breath, you suck in mercy. Every time you drew breath today, you sucked in the mercy of God. And sinner, tonight, what a privilege you have. You owe your very existence to God. God could have cut you off long ago. But what a mercy tonight to be reproved.
to be shown that you're on the wrong way, that you're on a dangerous pathway, a pathway that will lead to damnation and hell, to being lost without God for all eternity. And how that you need to turn around, how that you need to repent of your sin. What mercy tonight has God shown to you? Oh, don't spurn his mercy. Don't reject his mercy. That brings us as well to the multiplicity of this warning and the detail. It says, he that being often reproved. Do you know, to be warned once about your eternal soul being in danger of being lost in God's, in a lost eternity in hell, to be told once about that is a mercy. But to be told more than once, and to be warned more than once, is down to the long-suffering nature of God. You've been warned of your need to be saved. You've been warned of your need to get right with God, and yet you do nothing about it. And God could have cut you off. Could have turned his back on you long ago. Yet God has been long-suffering with you. God has been merciful. God has been gracious. And so tonight he comes and he warns you again. How long suffering is God with the sinner? Remember the days of Noah? Men's heart were wicked. The imagination of their heart was only evil continually. And he sent Noah, the preacher of righteousness, to go and warn the people. Judgment was coming, the flood was coming, to build the ark. The only refuge was in the ark. Yet what did man do? Man continued on in his sin. But for 120 years, God was merciful. But then one day his mercy was past, and his wrath came. Because when God shut the door of that ark, and just a matter of days later, even the extension of those days was down to the mercy of God. But then the floods came, and the people perished. Noah was shut in to the refuge. Noah was shut in, Noah and his family, the only ones that were saved, and everyone else perished. Because they rejected the mercy of God. What a mercy tonight that God has lengthened your days until this very moment. But be warned. Be warned, even as God warned the people in Noah's day, my spirit shall not always strive with man. And while God's spirit is striving, I urge you, be saved. God's merciful to you tonight. There's the detail of this warning, but I want you to see, secondly, with me here, there's the defiance of this warning. The defiance is summed up there in verse number 1 in 3 words, hardeneth his neck. How many have defied the health warnings that have been issued over recent times? Still continue to meet together in large groups and still continue to defy the warnings that have been issued. But what a greater defiance tonight. Having heard the gospel, having heard your need to be saved, having heard that you are a sinner, that you're under the wrath of God, having heard that Jesus Christ is your only Savior, having heard that same message week after week, and yet tonight you have defied that message, you have hardened your heart to the gospel. That word hardeneth there in verse number 1, it carries the idea of this thought that you are all right by yourself. It carries the thought that within yourself you're strong enough in your sin and that you don't need God. It's an awful thing when sin has so blinded your heart to see you don't need God.
It's an awful thing in our nation tonight that sin has so blinded the hearts and the lives and the minds of people that they don't even think about God. They don't even turn to God. And yet tonight, there you are, sitting in your own home, and you know you're a sinner, you know you need to be saved, you know you're not right with God, and yet you've defied that message, you're not saved. Oh, tonight you still think you'll be all right. You don't need Christ. Oh, I've lived my life long enough without Christ, I'll do without him now, I'll get to heaven without him now. Listen, you won't. You won't. There's only one way to heaven, and it's through the Lord Jesus Christ. It's through faith in him, repentance from sin. And if you have not come to Christ in repentance, you've never turned away from your sin, you've never received Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're on your way to hell tonight. There is a way that seemeth right unto man, but the ends are all for the ways of death. Your ways seem right. Oh, sinner, tonight may you realize that the way you're on is a terrible way. It's a devastating way. Oh, that tonight you would come to Jesus Christ. Listen, don't harden your heart anymore. Having been so privileged, and yet you are so foolish. Think you can continue on in your sin and escape God's judgment. You've hardened your neck. How often did God describe the people as being a stiff-necked people? Stiff-necked people. They refuse to follow the instructions of their master. They refuse to go the way of God. They went their own way. They did their own thing. And isn't that what you're doing tonight? I'll be all right my own way. No, you won't. No, you won't. You're like that stubborn, rebellious animal, hardening yourself against the instructions of the master. And tonight you've defied God. You've defied his mercy. You've defied his grace. You've rejected him. You may not openly admit that. But if you're not saved tonight, then that's exactly what you've done. You have defied the mercy of God. You have hardened your heart, and you have said, no God for me. The detail of this warning: he that been often reproved. There's the defiance of this warning: hardeneth his neck. Is that you? As we close this evening, I want you to see the destruction in this warning. If you haven't listened up until this point, I want you to listen now. For the last few moments, I want you to listen like never before. I want you to realize this is God's warning, not to you, not globally. This is God's warning to you personally. You have been reproved. You have been warned. You who have hardened your neck, listen. Listen now. Shall suddenly be destroyed. And that without warning. Suddenly destroyed, and that without warning. You see, if you continue on in this rebellion to God and this defiance against the gospel of Christ, God says in his word, you shall suddenly be destroyed without warning. Notice there is the sureness of this destruction shall. Maybe you think you're invincible tonight. God will not touch you. But God says you shall be destroyed. And you stand before God on that day of judgment, that great white throne of judgment, to answer for why you've rejected the gospel. Your one wish will be that God will have changed his mind. But God will not change his mind. God will be faithful to his person and to his holiness, to his wrath and to his justice. And you stand before him in your sin, he will punish you and damn you to a lost eternity. You can be sure of that. There's not only the sureness of it, there's the swiftness of it. Suddenly. Suddenly. Many, sadly, are being taken out of this world with COVID-19. And the death toll is rising day after day. But there are others as well, suddenly taken out with other illnesses and with no illnesses. Suddenly cut off. You think you'll go to your bed tonight, you'll sleep well, and you'll rise in the morning. But you could be suddenly cut off. That's how swift it comes. We read in the Gospel of Luke of that farmer who had all his plans for living. And he surveyed his kingdom and his wealth and all of his empire, his farm. It was going well. He said, I'm going to pull down all those little barns. They're not big enough anymore. I'm going to build bigger and I'm going to expand my empire. I'm going to make more money. God came to him and said, thou fool, this night thy soul shall be required of thee. And then who shall these things be? Don't be a fool tonight. Your soul could be required of you. Then there is the severity, finally. Without remedy. You see, tonight, there are no escape routes in hell. There are no fire exits in hell. Hell is a place of eternal damnation. Minute after minute, hour after hour, day after day, you will be tormented in the flames of hell, and there is no way out. No way out. There is no way back. When God pronounces on that day of judgment before you and says, depart from me, there is no appeal. There's no pleas for clemency and mercy, because God's mercy is gone. Shall suddenly be destroyed. That without remedy. That's why the Lord issues the invitation to you tonight. That's why God in mercy and love to your soul pleads with you, calls you, come and be saved. And tonight in your home, I plead with you earnestly, wherever you are, listen, heed this warning. Not because I say it, because I don't say it. This is the word of God. Heed the warning tonight. Get to Christ tonight. Be saved tonight. You come to him. You turn from your sin. You acknowledge that before God you're a sinner. You acknowledge that Christ is your only Savior. He says, I'll save you. And he clear the debt of your sin. Tonight you can be saved. But don't disobey or defy the warning anymore. Because he that been often reproved hardeneth his neck, shall suddenly be destroyed. That without remedy. What an awful thing it would be to go into a lost eternity and in your ears ringing this warning from God. What an awful thing it would be to stand before God and in your ears ringing this warning from God, the greatest health warning to your soul. He that been often reproved, hardeneth his neck, shall suddenly be destroyed, not without remedy. Come to Christ tonight. While there is time, listen to the warning of Scripture. Flee from the wrath to come. And this evening receive Jesus Christ as your Savior. You come to him. He'll wash your sins away. He'll cancel out every debt of your sin. And you will be forever secure in Christ. And the wrath of God cannot touch you. Because you come to Christ, receive him as your Savior, then you are saying that Christ's sacrifice on the cross is enough for me, is all I need. You're saying his blood is enough to cover and to cleanse me from my sin. You're saying I don't need anything else but Christ. Will you come to him tonight? Will you heed the warning? Softly and tenderly, the Lord has been calling and the Lord has been pleading. Will you come home? Will you come to Christ tonight? The detail of that warning, been reproved. The defiance, harden your neck. Don't harden yourself to the gospel tonight. And the destruction shall be cut off, destroyed, suddenly and without remedy. Oh, come to Jesus Christ tonight while he is pleading. Listen to the words of this final hymn, softly and tenderly. Jesus is pleading. And while he pleads with you, come to him tonight. Let me thank you tonight for watching and for joining with us. And if you want to speak to us, make sure you get in contact with us after the broadcast. Message us, phone us, whatever. If you're concerned for your soul, you want to be saved, and sinner tonight, come. Come to Jesus Christ, ere it be too late. Let's bow in prayer. Eternal God and our Father, we pray that you would be pleased by thy Holy Spirit to speak on. And Lord, in those soft, tender tones of the Saviour, bring the lost to thyself, O God, we pray. O God, we plead tonight for those who are listening, those who are watching out of Christ. Save their souls tonight. Bring them, Lord, into that full assurance of sins forgiven through faith in Jesus Christ. Lord, we lay the issues now of this meeting before thee. We ask, O God, that as the voice of man falls silent, may the Spirit of God speak on. Thank the Lord for being with us tonight, for help given. We ask, O God, you'll continue to be with us throughout the hours of this night. And most of all, it is our prayer tonight, may the Spirit of God be pleased to convict of sin and bring sinners to himself in salvation. Answer prayer. In the Saviour's name we pray. Amen. Amen. Again, we thank you for being with us tonight. The Lord bless you, and the Lord be with you, and the Lord keep you all safe. Thank you.